Introduction. The word architecture is derived from the Latin word tecton, which means builder. The architecture is derived from a Latin word tecton, which means builder. So as soon as the early man began to build his or her shelter to live in, the science of architecture started. Okay. The sculpture, on the other hand, is derived from the Proto-Indo-European root. Kel, which means to cut or cleave. I repeat all these things once again. So as soon as the early man began to build his or her shelter to live in, the science of architecture started. The sculpture, on the other hand, is derived from Proto-Indo-European root kel, which means to cut or cleave. Okay, sculpture essentially means to cut or cleave. The sculptures are smaller works of art, either handmade or with the tools, and more related to the aesthetics than engineering and measurements. These sculptures more related to the aesthetics, not related to more than engineering and measurements. This is very much related to the aesthetics more than engineering and measurements. So the difference between architecture and sculptures, the first point, according to the size and scope, the architecture refers to the design and construction of buildings. But sculpture, on the other hand, sculptures are relatively smaller three-dimensional works of art. But architecture is the design and construction of buildings. But sculptures, three-dimensional work of small work of art. Oh, so when it comes to material used, architecture generally uses mixture of various metals, mixture of various types of materials like stone, wood, glass, metals, and but in sculpture, a single piece of sculpture is usually made of a single type of material. Okay. So principle, according to principle, the architecture involves study of engineering and engineering mathematics. It requires detailed and accurate measurements. But on the other hand, sculptures involves creativity and imagination and may not depend as heavily on accurate measurements. Okay. For example, Taj Mahal, Red Fort. This is for architecture. So sculptures, you can have Nataraja's image, Dancing Girl. Okay. Indian architecture. The story of Indian art and architecture is a story of evolution. From the ancient Harappa civilization to the British rule, the buildings and sculptures have a narrative of their own. I repeat, from the ancient Harappa civilization, Harappa Valley civilization, to the British rule, the buildings and sculptures have a narrative of their own. The emergence and the decay of great empires, the invasion of foreign rulers who gradually became indigenous, the confluence of different cultures and styles, etc. These are all have a narrative of their own in the Indian art and architecture. What are all those? The first one is the emergence and decay of great empires. And the second one is the invasion of foreign rulers. And third one is the confluence of different culture and styles. Okay, etc. So these are all reflected in the evolution of Indian architecture and sculptures. Moving on. Classification of Indian architecture. The first classification is ancient India, and second one is medieval India, third one is modern India, according to the age. Okay. In ancient India, there are five classifications are there. First one is Harappa, second one Maurya, third one post Maurya, fourth one Gupta, fifth one South Indian art. These are all according to the timeline of which they have been evolved in the architecture field. In Middle India, Delhi Sultanate and Mughal art. In modern India, Indo-Gothic style and Neo-Roman style. I'll repeat all of this once again. In ancient times, Harappa, after that Maurya, after that Post-Maurya, after that Gupta, after that South India. In medieval India, first one is Delhi Sultanate, second one is Mughal art. In modern India, first one is Indo-Gothic and second one is Neo-Roman style. So let's move on to Harappan art and architecture. A flourishing civilization emerged on the banks of the river Indus in the second half of the 3rd millennium BCE. I repeat, the flourishing civilization emerged on the banks of the river Indus. It is also called Sindhu. In English, we used to call Indus. So this Harappan art and architecture emerged as a civilization, flourished civilization on the banks of Indus River. In the second half of 3rd millennium BCE, in the second half of 3rd millennium means 2500 BC around. So, and spread across a large parts of northwestern and western India. I'm sorry. Second half of 3rd millennium BC means 3500 BC, okay. And this Harappan art and architecture spread across large parts of northwestern and western India. It doesn't appear in South India. It is spread only in the northwestern part of India and western part of India. This is what we know as Harappan civilization or Indus Valley civilization. A marked feature of this ancient civilization was vivid imagination and artistic sensibilities exuded by the numerous sculptures, seals, potteries, jewelries found at the excavation sites. What are all the things found at the excavation sites? The first one is sculptures, second one seals, potteries and jewelries. These are all found at the excavation sites. This shows the people's vivid sense of imagination and artistic sensibilities. Harappa and Mohenjo-Daro, the two major sites of the civilization. These two are very important sites of this Harappan Valley civilization. First one is Harappa and second one is Mohenjo-Daro, are among the earliest and finest example of urban civic planning. Urban civic planning. So this is a very important capabilities. This is a very great capabilities and competence that the Harappan people have. That is urban civic planning. The planned network of roads, houses and drainage systems indicate the planning and engineering skills that developed during those times. Okay, the planned network, the roads are well planned, houses and drainage systems, the flourished and developed houses and burnt bricked houses and burnt bricked masonry and drainage system, closed drainage system. These are all indicate the planning and engineering skills that those people having during those times. Some important sites of the Indus Valley civilization and archaeological findings are Harappa. So this Harappa is present in Pakistan on the banks of Ravi River, River Ravi. I repeat, Harappa is not present in India. So this is a very important point. This can be, this kind of statements can be asked in prelims. So Harappa is present in Pakistan on the banks of Ravi. Two row of six granaries with big platform, stone symbol of Lingam and Yoni, mother goddess figure, wheat and barley in wooden mortar, dyes, copper scale and mirror. So these are all found at the excavation site of Harappa. I repeat once again, two row of six granaries with big platform. Granaries, two rows of six granaries with big platform. Second one is the stone symbol of Lingam and Yoni. So Lingam and Yoni present in Harappan civilization. So around 3500 BC. Mother goddess figure is also found at Harappan civilization, Harappan site. So wheat and barley in wooden mortar, wheat and barley in wooden mortar. Dice, copper scale and mirror. So moreover, sculpture of dog chasing a deer in bronze metal and red sandstone of male torso have been excavated. So I repeat, sculpture of dog chasing a deer in bronze metal and a red sandstone of male torso have been excavated in Harappa. So I repeat all of this once again. In Harappa is present in Pakistan, so on the banks of Ravi River. So there we found two row of six granaries with big platform and a stone of stone symbol of Lingam and Yoni, mother goddess figure, wheat and barley in wooden mortar, dice, copper scale and mirror. Moreover, sculpture of a dog chasing a deer in bronze metal and red sandstone of male torso. So let's move on. Mohenjo-daro. This Mohenjo-daro is also present in Pakistan. It is not present in India. So this presents in on the river Indus. The Harappa present on the river Ravi. The Mohenjo-daro present on the river Indus. The citadel, the great bath, the great granary, the post cremation burial, sculpture of bearded priest, the famous bronze statue of dancing girl and Pashupati seal. So these are all found at Mohenjo-daro. I repeat once again all of this. The citadel is a fort. So the great bath, the great granary, post cremation burial, sculpture of bearded priest, the famous bronze statue of the dancing girl and Pashupati seal. These are all found at Mohenjo-daro. Third one is Dholavira. This Dholavira is present in Gujarat, India. I repeat, Dholavira present in Gujarat. There we found giant water reservoir, unique water harnessing system, stadium, dams and embankments, inscriptions comprising 10 large sized signs like an advertisement boat. I repeat all of this once again. Giant water reservoirs, unique water harnessing system, stadium, dams and embankments, inscription comprising 10 large sized signs like an advertisement boat. So this Dholavira is mainly mainly comprising of water related things. So like for example giant water reservoirs, unique water harnessing system, stadiums, dams and embankments, inscriptions comprising of 10 large sized signs like an advertisement board. The next one is Lothal or Manchester of Indus Valley Civilization. So this is also present in Gujarat. So Gujarat has two sites. The first one is Dholavira, second one is Lothal. Dholavira is purely comprising of water related things. This Lothal of comprising important site for naval trade. Important site for naval trade, and it's had a dockyard. Dockyard means it's a kind of a repair works for the ships. Okay, dockyard, practice of burial of cremated remains, practice of burial of cremated remains. So this cremated remains had been buried. So these kind of practices have been found in Lothal. Okay, the cremated remains have been buried. So rice husk, fire altars, painted jar, modern day chess, terracotta figure of horse and ship, instrument for measuring 45, 90 and 180 degree angles, practice of burial of cremated remains. These are all found at Lothal. I repeat once again, the first one is important site for naval trade. Naval trade. This is a very important site for naval trade because this presents on the coastal region. This Lothal is found near coastal region in Gujarat. So this obviously having a dockyard, and these people having a practice of burial of cremated remains, and rice husk found, fire altars found, painted jar found, modern day chess, terracotta figures of horse and ship, instrument for measuring 45, 90 and 180 degree angles. These are all found at Lothal. So next one is Rakhi Garhi. So this Rakhi Garhi is in Haryana. Rakhi Garhi present in Haryana is considered to be the largest site of Indus Valley civilization. This is considered to be the largest site of Indus Valley civilization. This is a very important statement. Which one is the largest site of Indus Valley civilization? Is Rakhi Garhi present in Haryana? Granary, cemetery, drain, terracotta bricks have been found there. First one is granary, cemetery, drains, terracotta bricks have been found. So main important thing is Rakhi Garhi present in Haryana, which is considered to be the largest site of Indus Valley civilization. So next, move on. Roper. This Roper is present located on the banks of Satluj in Punjab. Okay, this Roper present in Punjab. Roper, Punjab. So there, India, dog buried with human oval pit burials. Dog buried with human oval pit burials. So, and copper axe are found. I repeat, Roper is present on the banks of Satluj River in Punjab. So the dog buried with human oval pit burials. Okay. So next site is Balatal and Kalibangan. So these are located in Rajasthan. Rajasthan, Balatal, Kalibangan. Balatal, Kalibangan. Balatal, Kalibangan. These are present in Rajasthan. Bangle factory found there. Toy carts, bones of camel, decorated bricks, citadel and lower town, fire altars. I repeat, in Balatal, Al-Kali and Kalibangan are present in Rajasthan. So there we found bangle factory, toy carts, bangle factory, bones of camel, decorated bricks, citadel and lower town, fire altars. A fire altar means an altar upon which burnt sacrifices were offered, as distinguished from one used for incense only. I mean, Fire altar means an altar upon which burnt sacrifices were offered. So next site is Surkotada. Surkotada. Surkotada is also present in Gujarat. So finally we got three sites in Gujarat. First one is Dholavira and second one is Lothal. So you have to remember we found three sites in Gujarat. First one is Dholavira, second one is Lothal, third one is Surkotada. Dholavira, Lothal, Surkotada. Dholavira, Dholavira, Lothal, Surkotada. Dholavira, Lothal, Surkotada. Dholavira, Lothal, Surkotada. These three sites found at Gujarat. In Surkotada, the first actual remains of the horse bones. I repeat, the first actual remains of the horse bones found at Surkotada. So the next place is Banavali. So this Banavali is also present in Haryana. So in Haryana, we got two sites. The first one is Haryana. In Haryana, the first one is Rakigarhi. Rakigarhi. And second one is Banavali. So you have to remember this. In Haryana, Rakigarhi and Banavali. Rakigarhi, Banavali. Rakigarhi, Banavali present in Haryana. Rakigarhi, Banavali. Rakigarhi, Banavali. These two sites present in Haryana. On the dried up Saraswati River. Okay. So this ancient Saraswati River, this dried up in Haryana. So on the sides of this Saraswati, dried up Saraswati River, this Banavali was found. Okay, where we got toy pluff, barley grinds, lapis lazuli, fire altars, oval shaped settlements, only city with radial streets. So this is a very important point. The only city with radial streets is Banavali. The only city with radial streets is Banavali. Okay. So this present in Haryana. In Haryana we got two sites. The first one is Rakigarhi, second one is Banavali. So this present on the banks of dried up Saraswati River, where we got type of barley grinds, lapis lazuli, fire altars, oval shaped settlements, only city with radial streets. So next site is Alamgirpur. This Alamgirpur is present in UP. So in UP we got only one site, that is Alamgirpur. In UP we got only one site, that is Alamgirpur. Alamgirpur, Alamgirpur. Okay, that is present in Meerut. On the banks of Yamuna River, Yamuna, easternmost sites of IBC. So this Alamgirpur present in Uttar Pradesh, located on the banks of Yamuna River, Yamuna River, Yamuna River. Okay. So this Alamgirpur is the easternmost site of IBC. This Alamgirpur is the easternmost site of Indus Valley Civilization. So major findings are broken blade made of copper. I repeat, broken blade made of copper, ceramic items and impressions of a cloth on trough. Trough means rough means a long narrow container from which farm animals eat or drink. Okay, So we used to call bani or a long narrow container from which farm animals eat or drink. That is called trough. So their impressions of a cloth on trough. So on the trough we got an impression of cloth in Alamgirpur. So the findings are broken blade made of copper, ceramic items and impressions of cloth and trough. So the next one is Mehgar. This Mehgar is present in Pakistan. So in Pakistan we got three sites. The first one is Harappa, second one is Mohenjo-daro, third one is Mehgar. Okay, Mehgar. So this is considered precursor to Indus Valley civilization. Pottery, copper tools have been found. So this Mehgar is precursor to Indus Valley civilization. It means it present even before Indus Valley civilization. Okay. So let's have a look at all these things once again. So in Pakistan we got three sites, Harappa, Mohenjo-daro and the last one, which one is Harappa, Mohenjo-daro and Mehgar. Sorry, Mehgar, Harappa, Mohenjo-daro and Mehgar. Okay. So in Gujarat we found three sites. First one is Dholavira, second one is Lothal and the third one is Surkotada. Dholavira, Lothal and Surkotada. In Haryana we got two sites. The first one is Raki Garhi. So this is a largest site of Indus Valley civilization. So the first one is Raki Garhi and second one is Banawali. Raki Garhi, Banawali, these two sites found in Haryana. And we found one site in Punjab, that is Roper. Okay. And in Rajasthan we found two sites. The first one is Balatal Kalibangan. Okay. So you have to remember all these facts because where these sites are located is a very important thing which can be asked in prelims. Okay. So in Haryana, Raki Garhi and Banawali. So in UP only one site we found, that is Alamgirpur. One site founded places are, first one is UP, that is Alamgirpur, and Punjab, that is Roper. So these two states have only one site. The Punjab having Roper, the UP having Alamgirpur. The Pakistan had three sites. The first one is Harappa, second one is Mohenjo-daro and Mehgar. So Haryana is having two sites, that is Raki Garhi and Banawali, Haryana. So and Gujarat is having three sites, that is Dholavira, Lothal and Surkotada. Okay. So let's move on to the architecture in Harappan civilization. Architecture in Harappan civilization. The remains of Harappa and Mohenjo-daro reveal a remarkable sense of town planning. The towns were laid out in a rectangular grid pattern. I repeat, the remains of Harappa and Mohenjo-daro reveal a remarkable sense of town planning. The towns were laid out in a rectangular grid pattern. The roads ran in a north, south and east-west direction and cut each other at right angles. The roads ran in north-south and east-west direction and cut each other at right angles. So I repeat the terminologies which are marked in red color. many times because it's very important to remember all these terminologies as it is. So the towns were laid out in a rectangular grid pattern. So the roads were cut each other at right angles. The big roads divided the city into a number of blocks, while the smaller lanes were used to connect the individual houses and apartments to the main roads. I repeat, the big roads divided the city into number of blocks, while the smaller lanes were used to connect the individual houses and apartments to the main roads. Mainly, three types of buildings have been found in the excavation sites. The first one is dwelling house. Dwelling house means where the normal people used to stay. The public buildings were administrative buildings and large structures. These are called public buildings and public baths. So as we all know, public baths. So these three types of buildings were there in Harappan civilization. The first one is dwelling house, second one is public buildings, third one is public baths. The Harappan used burnt mud bricks. Burnt mud bricks of standardized dimension for the purpose of construction. Many layers of well-baked brick were laid out and then joined together using gypsum mortar. Many layers of well-baked brick were laid out and then joined together using gypsum mortar. So in this picture you can see the citadel is an upper portion where the administrative buildings were used to construct. Administrative buildings are public buildings used to construct in citadel, and lower city where dwelling houses were constructed. Okay, the city was divided into two parts, an upraised citadel and the lower part of the city. An upraised citadel in the western part, usually upraised citadel in the Harappan civilization was at western part of this city. Okay, this upraised citadel was used for constructing buildings of large dimensions such as granaries, administrative buildings, pillared halls, courtyard. I repeat, these upraised citadels were used for constructing buildings of large dimensions such as granaries, administrative buildings, pillared hall, courtyard. I repeat, granaries, it's also a large dimension construction. Administrative buildings also large dimension constructions, and pillared hall also large dimensions, and courtyard was also a large structure. Okay, some of the buildings in the citadel might have been the residence of the rulers and aristocrats. Okay, some of the buildings in the citadel might have been the residence of the rulers and aristocrats. However, Indus Valley civilization sites do not have large monumental structures such as temples or palaces for rulers, unlike Egyptian and Mesopotamian civilization. Usually in Egyptian and Mesopotamian civilization, there were large monumental structures like temples and palaces for rulers, and temples were there in Mesopotamian and Egyptian civilization. But here, in contrary, in the Indus Valley civilization or Harappan civilization, these sites do not have any large monumental structures like temples or palaces. So this is a very important statement. Moving on, then granaries were intelligently designed with strategic air ducts and raised platforms, which helped in storage of grains and protecting them from pests. I repeat, the granaries were intelligently designed with strategic air ducts and raised platforms. strategic air ducts and raised platforms. These two are very important factor to store the grains grains by protecting them from the pests. Okay, so moving on, an important feature of the Harappan cities is the prevalence of public baths. Okay, important feature is the public bath, prevalence of the public baths, which indicate the importance of ritualistic cleansing in their culture. See, their ritualistic cleansing culture, the rituals were there in the Harappan civilization. So it indicates, the public baths indicates the ritualistic cleansing of their culture. So these baths also had an array of galleries and rooms surrounding it. These baths also had an array of galleries and rooms surrounding it to change the clothes for women's and all. So it's a very standardized form of public bath. So the most famous example of public bath is the Great Bath in the excavated remains of Mohenjo-Daro. So this Great Bath was present in Mohenjo-Daro. Okay, that there are no cracks or leaks in the Great Bath speaks volumes about the engineering capabilities of the Harappan civilization. So even today, there are no cracks and leaks in the Great Bath. So it shows the engineering capabilities of the Harappan civilization. Okay, moving on. In the lower part of the city, a small one-roomed houses have been found. One-roomed houses have been found, which might have been used as quarters by the working class people. In the lower part of the city, small one-roomed houses have been found, which might have been used as a quarters by working class people. Some of the houses have stairs, which indicate they might have been double storied. Yes, if there have been a stairs, then definitely it is a symptom. It is a it shows the house had double storied. Okay, the most buildings have private wells and bathrooms and are properly ventilated. The most striking feature of the Harappan civilization is the advanced drainage system. This is a very important feature, striking feature of the Harappan civilization. So advanced drainage system. The small drains ran from each house and were connected to larger drains running alongside the main roads. I repeat, the small drains ran from each house and were connected to larger drains running alongside the main road. So this drainage system is, it seems the modern drainage system, isn't it? So there is no any difference between this modern drainage system and Harappan drainage system. Even today also, we are following the same pattern of drainage system. So the drains were covered loosely to allow regular cleansing. Wow. The drains were covered loosely to allow regular cleansing and maintenance. The cesspits or manholes, the cesspits were placed at regular intervals. The importance placed on hygiene. Okay, they gave a very much importance to hygiene, both personal and public, is a quite impressive. Okay, so presence of wells has also been observed at many sites. Okay, many scholars argue that the Mesopotamian people of Tigris-Euphrates Valley, called Indus Valley civilization as Meluha, many Indus Valley seals have been found in Mesopotamia. I repeat, this is a extra note, this is not an important, but I repeat once again, many scholars argue that the Mesopotamian people of Tigris-Euphrates Valley called Indus Valley Civilization as Meluha, because many Indus Valley seals have been found in Mesopotamia. Sculptures of Harappan civilization. The Harappan sculptures were extremely adept at handling three-dimensional volumes. The most commonly found were seals, bronze figures, and potteries. The most commonly found were seals, bronze figures. The seals, bronze figures, and potteries. Sorry, so only these three: seals, bronze figures, and potteries. The first one is seals. Archaeologists have found numerous seals of different shapes and sizes all across the excavation sites. The archaeologists have found numerous seals of different shapes and sizes all across the excavation sites. While most seals are square, it was found that triangular, rectangular, and circular seals were also used. But most seals are square, and triangular, rectangular, circular seals were also used, but mostly the seals were in the shape of square. Okay. Steatite, a soft stone found in the river beds, was also the most common material used to make seals. The most common material used to make seals was steatite, a soft stone. It is a sandstone found in the river bed, that is steatite. Yet agate, chert, copper, faience, and terracotta seals have also been found. Agate, chert, copper, faience, and terracotta. These seals have also been found. So some instances of copper, gold, ivory seals have also been found. So totally, mainly they were used steatite for the purpose of seal making. So along with that, agate, chert, copper, faience, terracotta, copper, gold, ivory. So these seals have also been found. So the statement can ask like this in prelims: the gold and ivory seals were not at all present in the Indus Valley civilization. This is a wrong statement. So this kind of statement can be asked in prelims. So we must be aware of all these small minor facts. So most seals have inscriptions in a pictographic script that is yet to be deciphered. I repeat, most seals have inscriptions in a pictographic script. Pictographic script that is yet to be deciphered. The script was written mostly from right to left, but bidirectional writing style, that is right to left on one line and left to right on another line, has also been found. Mostly the script was written from right to left, but bidirectional writing style has also been found. Okay. So the script was written mostly from right to left, not like us. It is a script like Urdu. So the Harappan civilization script was like Urdu. Usually they used to write from right to left, that is like Urdu, but bidirectional writing style has also been found. Animal impressions were also there, generally five, which were carved intaglio on the surface. Animal impressions were also there, generally five, which were carved intactly on the surface. So this statement can also be asked in the prelims. Animal impressions. The seals doesn't have any animal impressions on the surface. No, this statement is wrong. The seals has animal impressions on the surfaces. The common animal motifs were unicorn, humped bull, rhinoceros, tiger, elephant, buffalo, bison, goat, markhor, ibex, crocodile, etc. I repeat all those things once again. Common animal motifs were unicorn, humped bull, rhinoceros, tiger, elephant, buffalo, bison, goat, markhor, ibex, crocodile, etc. However, no evidence of cow has been found on any seal. So this is a very important statement. No evidence of cow has been found on any seal. No evidence of cow has been found on any seal. Generally, the seals had an animal or human figure on one side and an inscription on the opposite side, or inscriptions on both the sides. Generally, the seals had animal or human figure on one side and an inscription on opposite side, or inscriptions on both the sides. Some seals had inscriptions on third side as well. The triangular seals has had an inscription on third side as well. Some seals have imagined animals as well as such as half man, half animal. So this is an imaginary animal. This is not present at all. So these kind of animals were also be there in the seals. Seals were primarily used for commercial purposes and helped in communication. The primary usage of the seals for commercial purposes for communication. Discovery of various seals in Mesopotamia and various sites such as Lothal points to the fact that seals were extensively used for trade. I repeat, discovery of various seals in Mesopotamia and various sites such as Lothal points. Lothal is a place where all naval trade begins. That is the hotspot for naval trade. Okay, so as Lothal points to the fact that seals were extensively used for trade. Yes, this is the primary objective of the seals was trade. Some seals with a hole on them have been found on dead bodies. So this indicates they might have used as amulets. So the secondary objective, the secondary usage of this seals were used as amulets, might have used as amulets carried on the persons of their owners, probably used as some form of identification. These amulets carried on the persons of their owners, so probably used as some form of identification. So mathematical images have also been found on some seals, which might have been used for educational purposes as well. Okay, some mathematical images have also been found. Seals with symbol similar to swastika design have also been found. So totally, the primary objective of the seal is trade. Secondary objective is they are used is as amulets, and another one is they used it for educational purposes because the mathematical images have also been found there. So some seals have swastika kind of a symbol design have also been found. So example, very important example is Pashupati seal and unicorn seal. This Pashupati seal is very important for examination. A steatite seal discovered at Mohenjo-daro depicts a human figure or a deity sitting cross-legged. Okay, Pashupati is a one form of Shiva. He is a god of all animals. So this seal is made up of a steatite. So this seal was discovered at Mohenjo-daro. It depicts human figure, Shiva figure obviously, or a deity sitting cross-legged. The figure referred to as a Pashupati wears a three-horned headgear. This is very important, and is surrounded by animals. If he is a Pashupati, then obviously he must have been surrounded by animals. An elephant and a tiger are there on the left side of the figure, while rhinoceros and a buffalo are seen on the right side. So this question, most probably, if they have, they might ask the prelims question in this chapter, they mainly focuses on this Pashupati seal or unicorn seal. So this is a very important statement. The elephant and tigers are on the left side of the figure, elephant and tiger, and buffalo and rhinoceros are present on the right side of the Pashupati. I repeat, elephant and tiger were present in the left side of the deity, and buffalo and rhinoceros are seen on the right side. Two antelopes are shown below seat of the figure. Antelopes means it's a kind of a deer. So these two antelopes are shown below the seat of the figure. So total five types of animals were present on Pashupati seal. In the left side, elephant, tiger; right side, rhinoceros, buffalo. Let's moving on. See, this is a Pashupati seal. You can see in the left side of that deity, there is a elephant and tiger. In the right side of that seal, we can see that the rhinoceros and buffalo. Under that seat, under the Pashupati seal, two antelopes were depicted. So this is unicorn seal. Unicorn means only one headgear, but Pashupati has three headgear on his head. Bronze figures. The Harappan civilization saw a wide scale practice of bronze casting. The bronze statues were made using lost wax technique or cire perdu. This is a very important terminology. Lost wax technique. Or cire perdu. So in this technique, wax figures are first coated with wet clay. The carved wax figures are first coated with wet clay and allowed to dry. So the clay coated figures are then heated. When heated, allowing the wax will comes outside, allowing the wax inside to melt. So the wax is then poured out through a tiny hole and liquid metal is poured inside the hollow mold. After the metal has cooled down and solidified, the clay coat is removed and metal figure of the same shape as the wax figure is obtained. Okay. Even now, this same technique is practiced in many parts of the country. For example, bronze dancing girl of Mohenjo-daro. This is a very important the statue of Harappan civilization. So in prelims the question may be asked on this bronze dancing girl. The dancing girl is the world's oldest bronze sculpture. Okay, the dancing girl is the world oldest bronze sculpture found in Mohenjo-daro. Okay, this is only four inch figure depicts a naked girl wearing only ornaments which include bangles in the left arm. You can see bangles in the left arm. She wore some bangles in her left arm and amulet and bracelet in the right arm. You can see in her right arm one amulet and one bracelet is there. So she stands in a tribhanga dancing posture, okay, with the right hand on her hip. So this posture is called tribhanga posture. Moving on, terracotta. Terracotta refers to the use of fire baked clay, okay, for making sculptures. Compared to the bronze figures, the terracotta sculptures are less in number. Okay, compared to bronze figure, the terracotta sculptures are very less in number and crude. They are not well designed, they are not well carved, they are crude in shape and form. So they were made using pinching method, okay, and have been found mostly in the sites of Gujarat and Kalibangan. Terracotta was generally used to make toys, animal figures, miniature carts and wheels, etc. This terracotta figures usually made up of fire baked clay and using method of pinching method, and the sites where these terracotta sculptures found is Gujarat and Kalibangan. So they usually, terracotta was generally used to make toys, animal figures, miniature carts and wheels. Example, mother goddess, mask of horned deity. Okay, this mother goddess is very important. The mother goddess figures have been found in many Indus sites, which highlights its importance. It is a crude figure of a standing female adorned with necklace hanging over prominent breasts. You can see here, this is a very crude form. It crude figures of a standing female adorned with necklace hanging over prominent breasts. So she wore a necklaces and she wears a loincloth and girdle. You can see she wears some loincloths and girdles. Okay, she also wears a fan shaped headgear. Okay, she wears a fan shaped headgear. Yeah, fan shaped headgear. Okay, the facial features are also shown very crudely. They are not well carved and lacks fineness. Yes, the fineness is not there. She was probably worshipped for prosperity. She might also have been a goddess of fertility cults. She might be worshipped for prosperity and fertility cults. Prosperity and fertility cults. Moving on, pottery. The potteries found at the excavation sites can be broadly classified into two kinds: plain pottery and painted pottery. The painted pottery is also known as red and black pottery. I repeat, two kinds: plain pottery. One is plain pottery and another one is painted pottery. The painted pottery is also known as red and black pottery. Okay. And it used red color to paint the background, and glossy black paint was used to draw designs and figures on the red background. This is a very, very important statement. So which color is background? Red color used as background, and black color, glossy black paint used to draw designs and figures on the red background. So background is red, so designs are in black. This is a very important thing here. So in painted pottery, this is also known as red black pottery, because red is background, black is designs. Trees, birds, animals and geometrical patterns were the recurring themes of the paintings. I repeat, trees, birds, animal figures, geometric patterns were the recurring themes of the paintings. Most of the potteries that have been found are very fine, fine wheel made wares. Okay, they are not crude, they're fine wheel made wares. Most of the potteries are fine wheel made wares, with a very few being handmade. Okay, you majorly the wares are made up of a wheel, very few being handmade. Some examples of polychrome pottery have also been found. Okay, so we cannot conclude that there is only red black potteries. There are some polychrome potteries were also there, though very rare. Okay, the potteries were used for three main purposes. Plain pottery, the first classification is plain pottery, right? So this plain pottery was used for household purposes, mainly storage of grains and water. Plain pottery used for household purposes. The miniature vessels, generally less than half an inch in size, were used for decorative purposes. You can imagine how half an inch in size that kind of miniature vessel they used to create means the hats off to them. Okay, so they usually used this kind of miniature vessels for decorative purposes. They are so marvelously crafted. Okay, they're so marvelously crafted, even now they evoke away, right? Some of the potteries were perforated with a large hole in the bottom and small holes across the sides. They might have been used for straining liquor. Okay, so there are main purposes is household purposes, second one is decorative purposes, third one is straining of liquor. Okay, you can see perforated pottery here and red and black pottery. Okay, this is a white and black image, so we cannot recognize. So quickly we can go through what we have studied now. Once again we can revise it. See, pottery, sculptures and pottery. We have studied sculptures and pottery. These are all sculptures we have studied. Okay, let's moving on. Next one is ornaments. The Harappans used a large variety of materials, from precious metals and gemstones to bones and even baked clay, to make ornaments. I repeat, Harappans used a large variety of materials like precious metals, gemstones, bones, baked clay to make ornaments. Both men and women wore ornaments like necklaces, fillets, armlets and finger rings. Girdles, earrings and anklets were worn only by women. Okay, So you can see what are all the anklet, what do you mean, what does it mean by anklet, and the meaning of earrings. You can search it in the Google, you can see the figures of those things so that you can understand properly. Can see necklaces, we all know fillets. I'm sorry, this is coming. I'm sorry. Armlets, we all know. Finger rings, we all know. So, girdles, earrings, and anklets. You can search girdles. You can see. These are all the girdles. These are worn by only by women. Okay. These are worn by only by women. Girdles, earrings, we all know, anklets. This is an anklets. So these are worn only by women. Okay. So beads. Moving on. Beads made from. Beads made from carnelian, amethyst, quartz, steatite, etc. I repeat. The beads made from carnelian, amethyst, quartz, steatite were quite popular and were produced on a large scale, as is evident from the factories discovered in the Chanhu Daro and Lothal, okay, in Gujarat. So the factories were used to produce a large number of beads made from carnelian, amethyst, quartz, and steatite. For fabric, the Harappans used cotton and wool, okay, for textile industry, let it say, in modern terminologies. For fabric, the Harappans used cotton and wool, which were spun by rich and poor alike. So everyone used to wear cotton and wool cloths. Spindles and wools were made from expensive faiences as well as cheap clay. The people of the time were conscious of fashion as well. So by all these things we can conclude they were conscious of fashion, okay, as can be inferred from the different styles of hair and beard. Okay. So these are some images of ornament found at Harappan civilization. So thus, we see that the artisans and sculptors of the Harappan civilization made giant strides in the field of architecture and sculpture. Okay. From a scientific city plan to artistic figures, this ancient civilization has left behind a legacy of skill and craftsmanship. The bust of the bearded priest is one of the excellent example of stone figures found in Indus Valley civilization. I repeat, the bust of the bearded priest, you can see in the image, So is the one of the excellent example of stone figures found in Indus Valley civilization. This is a stone figure. So it is the figure of a bearded man draped in a shawl with the trefoil patterns. You can see in the image, one shawl is there and with a trefoil pattern. The eyes are elongated and half closed as in meditation. So the figure has an armlet on the right hand and a plain woolen fillet across the head. This figure has armlet on the right hand, you can see here, armlet on the right hand and a plain woolen fillet across the head. Okay, let's move on. The red sandstone of a male torso. Male torso means the body part which doesn't have head. The whole body except head is called torso. The red sandstone of male torso is another specimen of rock sculpture. The torso has a frontal posture with well-baked shoulders and prominent abdomen. You can see prominent abdomen. There are socket holes in the neck and the shoulders. Oh my god, there are socket holes in neck and the shoulders, probably for the attachment of the head and arms.